part of the time that, you know, seeing all you guys and meeting everybody and all the local fans and the, you know, the following of the movies and horror films, and especially Halloween, it's a great honor to have been a part of that and look back on those fond memories and, you know, everybody looks the same, we're just a little bit grayer, I think, but, you know, no one's aware. But I do want to thank you all for coming out, and it's a great honor to be here. Thank you.
Everybody appreciating all the stuff we did. So I done Halloween 1, of course, and a couple other things. And then I got a phone call from Steven Spielberg. You heard. about doing Poltergeist. And in the meantime, I got a phone call from Deborah, and she said, well, we're doing Halloween 2, we do that, and I did some thinking, and I said, okay. And so I did, and that's why you're all here.
Enjoyment on that set. I'm so thrilled to see people I haven't seen in 40 years. Some people I haven't seen in 40 years. So anyway, thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it.
You just got to know that we all appreciate you so much. And can't believe that you love us, because we love you.
Okay, so my story is not like any of theirs. And you know why? Because I'm the only Black woman that ever got to star in one of these movies before Tyler Banks. Sort of
to Deborah Hill, was not on her list because she was very good to me on the set, especially during the good scene. She sort of stood up for me and stuck by my side, and I really, really, really appreciated her for that. So I think we all learned.
Thank you. take out that scene with the apple and the raisin days. I said, well, Dino, I mean, I'm not sure who has Final Cut here, but I can tell you that John and Deborah loved that scene. And I left it at that, and in the end, that scene stayed in. But that was a good example of the politics that end up pretty much on any film, you know, unless you have absolute Final Cut. So there is a version, I think. Leo and I did commentary on Blu-ray a couple of years ago, and as I recall, the ending is the ending with Jimmy waking up, or a version of it. It's not quite the right shot, but it's pretty close. And I like that because I had always felt that sort of my last kind of scare, and then the reveal was really kind of fun. But you know, you can only make your case, and then at some point somebody decides either they like that or they don't, and for whatever reason, Universal or Gustavo or I think John never liked that ending. I can't really remember, but somewhere somebody just felt like the movie's over and that it should just be over, and that's the version that was released. And then later on, you know, there are a couple other scenes. Pam was talking about a scene that I love that it's never made it back. I have no idea where that footage is, but there was a scene where when she's by herself at the nurse's station and Michael Myers walks into the children's wing, the nursery actually, and there's a wind-up, a mechanical, I think it was a gorilla, and he bumps the table and the gorilla starts clapping the cymbals, and it was really scary, and he disappears in the closet, and she hears this sound down the hallway, and there's no lights. She goes down the hallway, and she comes to the door, and she looks in, and everything's quiet, the kids are quiet, but there in the middle of the room on this table is this stuffed animal, this mechanical animal, and then we see from her, from Michael Myers' point of view through the slats in the closet as she comes toward the table, and you're just waiting for him to jump out, and comes toward the table and she turns off the mechanical gorilla, and the sound stops and it's quiet for a second, and you're like, oh my god, oh my god. She turns and walks away, and everything goes, oh. and it didn't make a cut, and I was disappointed in that. Because I thought, you know, here's a different scene from what you're expecting. It sort of plays with your expectations, and it also keeps you off balance, because up until then, every time you saw Michael Myers, somebody's died, here was an interesting situation. What did it mean that he didn't kill somebody? Was it because of the children? Was it because, you know, it had a lot going on, I thought. But it's just one of those things that doesn't always, you know, doesn't always make the cut. And then, unfortunately, that's the one scene when, you know, we were able to put stuff back. That scene, I don't know, that scene is gone. So it's too bad because I really love that scene. But it happens.
And he would be off to the side when we were setting up, pacing back and forth and talking to himself. And I wondered, you know, is he like really crazy or something? So I wandered over to find out. He was going over his lines. He was such a pro that even though this was presumably a small movie, he was intent on doing as good a job as he possibly could. So he was working on his lines all constantly. And that really impressed me about, you know, because I've worked with other actors who kind of walk on the set and say, okay, so now where do I stand, what do I say? And he was prepared.
In addition to being a consummate professional, he was very funny in a very wry, subtle way. And so many of my scenes were in the car with him. And so they'd be changing the light or doing something, and Donald would say something hysterical. And of course, I'd be laughing, and then they'd call for action, and he's pulled himself together impeccably. And professionally, and I'm left there trying to pull myself together thinking about how funny he was. So he was just a delight, charming, wry, odd, but delightful human being.
it was an honor, to work with him.
I honestly was pretty nervous when I first started working with him because, you know, it was my first film and he was so experienced. And he was so easy to work with. I mean, he took, there was very little communication needed. He didn't need to really direct him very much. And he made very subtle adjustments each time. And he just, I was surprised how sort of easy to work with he was. He just seemed, not to needy. He wasn't needy at all as an actor. The image that's so interesting to me is in the kind of final scene with him. I just thought he brought so much into that hospital room from the time he's stabbed and the way he falls backwards against the gurney. We were all really scared and concerned, you know, because the acting was so good. He sort of takes this blade and he falls backwards and he just completely sort of sold out. Fell back against the gurney, and you know, and it falls awkwardly, and I don't know, his whole body kind of changed in that scene.